First of all, good morning. And Father Tom Hayes filling in for the funeral today. I invite you to stand as we begin. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, fellowship of the Spirit be with you all. We bless Kate's body with the holy water that recalls the day in which she was baptized, the day in which she was brought to church, clothed in white, acknowledged as a child of God, and pointed in the direction of God's kingdom. As Catholics, we believe you come to know the Lord, the experiences of life, the good, the bad, the bitter, the sweet. Life's really a journey, a pilgrimage, until when our body fails, we're absorbed into the life of God. Kate has made that final transition now. She is absent physically, but very much present spiritually. So we give thanks to God for the gift that she has been to us as an extended family, as we commend her back to the Lord. It's a time of fulfillment for her, a time of separation and loss for you. And we're reminded what Jesus did when he was saying farewell to his friends. On the night before he died, he gathered them at table. He identified himself with the bread and the wine. This is my body. This is my blood. Do this in my memory. I'll always be with you. And so Christians have been sharing the breaking of the bread for the past 2,000 years. It's a way in which we have communion with the Lord. So we share that same Eucharist today, asking the Lord to fill some of the emptiness in your hearts as we give thanks to God for Kate and ask his consolation as you deal with his loss at this time. So let's begin with the first song. Shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. Your words in foreign lands all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid, I go before you always, come follow me, and I will give you rest. So let us pray. Lord God, our Father, you've set a limit to this present life so as to open up an entry into eternity. We humbly beseech you, by the grace of your mercy, that you command the name of your servant Kate to be inscribed in the book of life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated now for the first reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. There is an appointed time for everything, and a time for every affair under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot the plant, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to be far from embraces, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. What advantage has the worker from their toil? I have considered the task which God has appointed for people to be busied about. God has made everything appropriate to its time and has put the timeless into their hearts. Without their ever discovering from beginning to end the work which God has done, I recognize that there is nothing better than to be glad and to do well during life. For every person, moreover, to eat and drink and enjoy the fruit of all their labor is a gift from God. I recognized that whatever God does will endure forever. There is no adding to it or taking from it. Thus has God done that he may be revered. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Goodness and kindness follow me. A reading from the second letter of Paul to Timothy. My life has been poured out as a libation, and the time for my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Glory, praise, and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Glory, praise,
and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. All who believe in me, even if they die, will never die.
I praise and honor to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Friends, the Lord be with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Have faith in God, my Father. Have faith also in me. For in my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I was going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." But Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated. You can sit there, it's okay. Yeah, sit. Save that seat for me. Well, even though I didn't have the privilege of knowing Kate in this life, it's pretty obvious that she was an exceptional person. And it's difficult when we have to acknowledge this mystery of death for someone who's been vibrant despite her health issues, is no longer with us physically. And yet, I think it's important that we take a little bit of time to process this mystery, this death. Because as Catholics, as Americans, we don't deal with death very well. We don't talk about it. We don't discuss it. We just leave it at the margins of your lives until it happens to someone you love. And then you have to start trying to make sense out of it. What's really going on here today in You know? What's it all about? We look to the traditions of our ancestors to help us process the mystery. In the first reading you chose from Ecclesiastes, I think I learned that from the birds, if you know what I mean. B-Y-R-D-S. That was a musical group back when I was in college. Do everything, turn, turn, turn. There's a season for everything. And a time for every purpose under heaven. And this is one of those times that it's part of the fabric of life. As I said at the beginning, the good, the bad, the bitter, the sweet. And that we have to acknowledge that this is, even though we don't deal with it very well, it's part of our everyday life, this mystery of death. And so we look to how our ancestors in the faith have dealt with it. And you see in the gospel today, Jesus is at that stage and towards the end of his public ministry where he knows that people are plotting against him, that he's going to be taken from them. He's on towards the end of his earthly life. And what does he say to his friends? Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Have some faith. And faith isn't the things you believe. Faith is trust. That's what faith is. Something in your heart in which you know that even though you can't control it, it's going to be okay. And even though it doesn't make sense, you have to acknowledge that there are some things that for which we are slow learners. Traditionally, people have talked about death as the separation of the body and the soul. That came out of the Greek culture that was dominant in the Mediterranean when Jesus was active as a preacher. And remember learning that you had to, you know, when the body left the soul went up to heaven and the body went down to the ground. And that's what death was about. But where'd that come from? Our Jewish ancestors in the book of Genesis talked about the earth as being flat, created in 7 days, right? And God put a dome over the earth, big light called the sun, lesser light the moon, holes in the dome to let the rain in, and that God lived up above the dome. And the purpose of life was to go live with God up above the dome. And so even though 400 or 500 years ago, Copernicus and Galileo helped us realize this, that primitive understanding of Earth doesn't hold water, basically, and that this universe that God has created and continues to create, and that continues to unfold, is a magnificent gift. They say there's more stars in the sky than there are grains of sand on all the seashores and planet Earth. This is a big, big universe. And to try to bring it down to our level, it's frustrating. There's just some things that are beyond our comprehension. But it's still okay to trust. It's still okay to have faith. And that's what Jesus was trying to get to the point across to his friends. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And I think that means that the way of the Lord is the truth, and it brings life. And I believe what I've been told. Kate was a faithful follower of her Lord. Not in any sanctimonious way, not standing on street corners talking about her Lord and Savior, but about the fabric of her life, the way she lived her life, the way she realized how important it was to reach out to others. As a nurse, as a visiting nurse, as a VA nurse, as a catechist, as a mom, as a spouse. It's amazing. It's amazing as it is as amazing as this universe in which we live. That there's something in us which is eternal.
And as it says in the song in the first reading, the Lord has put the timeless in our hearts, that which is beyond our control. And that's what makes us alive, even beyond the limits of death. Rather than think of body and soul, I like to use a more contemporary metaphor of who we are as human persons. We really are a web of relationships. What makes us who we are, the people whose lives we've touched, and the people who've touched our lives. And relationships, you know, endure even when someone's physically absent. Think about all the relationships this woman developed over her years. Think about the relationship she has with you, you know. And for those of you who are closely connected, I like to remind you that she's going to haunt you. And probably has started doing that already. You know? Because she's still alive. Years ago, I was in Pastor Urban's Connecticut, and this kid says to me at his father's grandfather's wake, "Where's my grandfather now?" I said, "Well, he's with God," thinking that that would shut the kid up, you know? But then he says, "Where's that?" So I said, "Well, where's God?" The kid says, "God's everywhere." I said, "Your grandfather's everywhere." You know, not limited by this body that doesn't work anymore. We're going to honor this body. We're going to use incense and holy water and rituals and all that stuff to acknowledge the importance of our body. But it's also recognition that Kate and that kid's grandfather is everywhere and as close to you as you allow her to be. So if there's any unfinished business, anything just you say, "I should have said, I should have done this, I should have done that, blah, 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 blah," you can beat yourself up if you want. Or you can just talk to her now. Because she's as close to you as you allow her to be. That's the mystery. And that's the blessing. So as St. Paul was writing to his protege, Timothy, in the second reading, it's towards the end of his life. What does he say to the younger man? "My life's being poured out. The time of my departure is at hand. I finished the race. I fought the good fight. I've kept the faith." And I think you can all say that about Kate as well. So let's be grateful. Let's be honest about the pain. I'm not trying to sugarcoat this loss. But let's just be honest. There's more to life than what we see. And if we want to have any trust in anything in this universe, have trust in God, who is the source of life, who gives us the strength to deal with whatever comes down the pike. And as you do that today, that's a good way of honoring this special woman who's touched so many lives and whose relationships continue to endure. Thank you, Kate. Did a good job. Got a good turnout. And I dare say you must have deserved it, because nobody's being paid to be here today. Let's just be thankful. Let's be honest about our feelings, but also about our faith. Let's stand and offer our petitions together. Prayer of the faithful.
We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for our beloved Kathleen. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In baptism, Kathleen received the light of Christ, scatter the darkness now and lead over her the waters of death to life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The family and friends of Kathleen seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and give them peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Family members and healthcare professionals care for the sick and the homebound, as Kathleen did for others and received as well. May they be sustained in their mission with the gifts of strength and compassion, bringing comfort and hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Kathleen's life was filled with joy and love of family and friends. May we honor her memory by seeing the good in others and celebrating all of life's moments, both big and small. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and will await us in the heavenly abode. Grant the deceased members of the Killian and O'Brien families and all the dead an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for all of our departed brothers and sisters, and grant them the fullness of life. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Please be seated now as the bread and wine are brought to the altar. Sisters, brothers, my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look favorably on our offerings of bread and wine, O Lord, so that your departed servant Kate may be taken into glory with your Son, in whose great mystery of love we are all united, and we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord be with you.
And with
your spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them
up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks, God our Father, for your many gifts to us, and now in a special way for your gift of life on earth, and your promise of life more beautiful beyond the grave. Now is a moment of sadness. We weep for Kate, who has gone from our midst, and yet
Even as we mourn, we reaffirm our trust in you. You are a God ever faithful to all that you have promised us. And so our sadness gives way to a joy, a consolation, and the hope that Kate now lives in your presence in a place of peace. Her death, pain, suffering are no more. And so we pray that not in anger and not yielding to the emptiness of grief like those who have no hope, but with faith in you, our living God. And so we join the choirs of angels in heaven as they sing forever to your glory.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
We praise you, God, our Father. We give you thanks. Look upon us with love beyond all understanding. You have made each of us but a little less than yourself. You blessed us above all your creation by giving us life and the power to love. You've chosen us to be your people. You made a dwelling place for yourself within our hearts. And Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. He was not ashamed to become one of us, to be human, to share our fears, our joys, to taste the beauty and the pain of human love. In Jesus, you understand all that is in us. And through him, you speak in a word of hope as we face once again this mystery of death. You help us to believe that beyond the limits of this life lies not darkness, but light. Not death at all, but life that never ends. And so with faith made strong, we gather about this table in the name of your Son, Jesus. And we remember all that you have done for us when you raised him from the dead. We pray that your Holy Spirit may come upon these gifts of bread and wine we offer you. They may become the body and blood of your Son. They may be present in our midst, giving praise to you as you deserve. And so it has been from the beginning. When in the night before he died, Jesus took bread in his hands and gave you thanks and praise. He broke the bread, he gave it to his friends. He said, take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. Same way, supper came to an end. He took a final cup of wine. Again, he gave you thanks and praise, Father. He passed the cup to his friends. He said, take this, all of you, and drink of it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you, for all, for the forgiveness of sin. So do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Father, we remember Jesus' own death upon the cross. The moments of grief and sorrow that came to those he loved. We recall even more. You raised him from the dead and so brought untold joy to all people. For in Jesus you blessed us with a hope and a promise. We shall live together with you in happiness and peace forever. May the power of your Holy Spirit come alive within us now
to strengthen us in that hope. Pray for all your people, Francis, our Pope, Everett, our Bishop, all who believe in your Son, Jesus, and all those who do not yet know his word of unending life. Pray for Kate, for all who have gone before us, that they find peace with you. But we pray also for ourselves. We may come to understand ever more deeply the gift we are to each other in this life, that we may not be saddened when for a time we must part in death, but rather turn our eyes in joy and thanksgiving to that day of promise when we shall be united once again. And we ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus, for through him alone the promise of life everlasting is given to all your people. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. 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 At the Savior's command, formed by divine teaching, we dare to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. And Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you." Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always. And we offer each other a sign of the Lord's peace. You take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
I have loved you.
Lord God, our Father, your Son, Jesus, has given us this sacrament of his body and blood to guide us on our pilgrim way to your kingdom. Mary, Sister Kate, who shared the Eucharist in her life, come to the banquet of life Christ has prepared for us all. And we ask this through Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And now we ask Kevin O'Brien to come and give a reflection on Kathleen's life.
Don't worry, Mom, I'm not going to start rapping. Good morning. Thank you all for coming. Kathleen, Mary, Lucille, Killian, O'Brien, Kate. To those who knew her the longest, Katie. But to myself, my brother Owen, my sister Mary, she was Mom. Mom loved to ask questions, which is ironic because she had all the answers. A curious know-it-all. While some prefer questions of a cosmic or existential nature, Mom favored a rapid-fire, quantity-over-quality approach. What'd you do this weekend? Where'd you go? What'd you eat? What did Liz eat? What was she wearing? Was it good? Was it expensive? Since when do you like seafood? Most times, she didn't bother waiting for the response before posing her follow-up inquiry. It was the asking of the question that was most important. One thing that did not need to be questioned was Mom's love of candy. Though she modified the spelling, replacing the D with a second N so that it was pronounced canny. She had an uncanny ability to procure, hoard, and ultimately consume her beloved canny. Everything was fair game, from fruity and chewy to chocolatey and crunchy. She did not discriminate. It may surprise some of you to know that Mom was an avid player of video games. From the early days of Nintendo, Zelda was her favorite, to Game Boy years later, which she only ever called Game Girl, before the ultimate sweet synthesis of her multiple interests, Candy Crush, which she only ever called Candy Crunch. Now, this game had a set limit on playing time, after which an interval of time had to pass before you could resume playing. Well, that just wasn't going to work for Mom. In a stroke of creative genius, she would routinely change the system clock settings on her tablet, springing her hours and days forward into the future, tricking the electronic gatekeepers into letting her back into her candy kingdom. That was Mom. She just never had a clue what day and time it actually was. Mom was an awful singer, but she loved to do it, a combination she passed on to her children. Thanks, Mom. In fact, her dear friend Kathy Mack told us that in their nursing school days at Maria College, they frequently attended midnight mass right here in this very church because it was the one place you were allowed to sing so loudly and so poorly. Mom, like the rest of our family, enjoyed the occasional alcoholic beverage. For many years, wine was her drink of choice. And while some grape enthusiasts might prefer a nice, expensive, vintage something or other, Mom was most comfortable with a silver pouch encased inside of a cardboard box. Later, she took a liking to Mike's Hard Lemonade, which she referred to as Mike and Ike's. This could be confusing when she'd say, "Kevin, grab me a Mike and Ike's," as she always had a box of that same candy in the next room. But it was a safe bet to just give her both, knowing that neither would go to waste. Celebrating the holidays was of the utmost special importance to Mom. As my sister Mary said, the house had the aesthetic of a TGI Fridays from the 90s, where every square inch was filled with a decoration of some kind. If it happened to light up or make sound or do both, well, that was just icing on the cake. In the upstairs hall,
it was Christmas year-round. The watchful eyes of Santa Claus, hundreds of them, recording who was naughty, Owen, excuse me, or nice, Mary. But more importantly to her, the holidays were an opportunity to gather with family and friends and for her to give, give, and give. The only things more plentiful than the decorations were the presents, often given with the words, "It's yours whether you want it or not." In her later years, unfortunately, Mom spent a fair amount of time in the hospital. And while she certainly never enjoyed her stays, she found a way, as only she could, to make the best of it, flexing and sharpening her nursing knowledge, as well as finding a never-ending rotation of fresh meat to pepper with questions. You'd go to visit her and ask for an update, and she would tell you nothing of a medical nature, but could relay to you the overnight nurse's full name, mother's maiden name, place of birth, SAT scores, favorite color, you name it. She was also surrounded by an army of co-conspirators willing to overlook hospital protocol by smuggling her contraband Diet Coke and other requested necessities. As I've mentioned, Mom was a registered nurse. She graduated from Maria College in 1973 and began working at Albany's VA hospital, administering to those who had survived the traumas of war and who faced greater challenges yet still to come. Later, she worked for decades with the Albany County Health Department, performing home visits for the most impoverished, underserved, and underrepresented populations, always treating people with compassion, respect, and a healthy dose of humor. They say laughter is the best medicine, and if that's true, then Mom was the ultimate healer. This past September, I had the joy and honor of marrying my beautiful wife, Liz. The luck of the Irish strikes again. For our mother and groom dance, Mom and I chose "All You Need Is Love" by the Beatles. The message is simple. All you need is love. Love is all you need. And my... and Mom always made it abundantly clear that we were all set in that department. Nothing mattered to Mom more than her family. She enjoyed a particularly special relationship with her two sisters, in addition to her three brothers. She loved her three children unconditionally, even when she couldn't keep our names straight. Kevin, Owen, Mary, whoever you are. She loved Buddy and Bailey, our two family dogs, and she doted on her two grandchildren, Connor and Nolan, loving to spoil them with gifts and treats. But the love of her life was my dad, Chuck, to whom she was married for 48 glorious, adventurous, and interesting years. It's worth noting that they are both Libras, with Mom being born on September 29th and Dad just a couple of weeks later on October 10th. Libra is represented by the scales, the ultimate symbol of balance. And where Mom was boisterous, Dad could be reserved. Where Mom could be impulsive, Dad was measured. Where Mom was patient, Dad was slightly less patient, shall we say? Mom was a lefty, like me, and Dad is right-handed. Together, they gave us the best of both worlds and provided the perfect roadmap on how to conduct yourself with grace and dignity, humility and good humor. To Mom, the act of shopping was both an art and a science, and she was Leonardo da Vinci, from countless garage sales to her all-time favorite, the Christmas tree shop. If you know, then you know. Despite not having a single drop of Italian blood in her veins, Mom made the best tomato sauce I will ever have tasted in my entire life. And I'm sure my Antorcia cousins, you know, might have something to say about that, but I stand by my claim. She loved to read books and to go to the movies. Mom loved children, but she adored naughty children. She had an affinity for Disney villains, her personal favorite being Maleficent. Something about misbehaving just appealed to her inner self. Mom always spoke what she was thinking, and it was obvious that she was always thinking because she was always speaking her mind. Such modern inventions as political correctness or having a filter did not interest her. She possessed a larger-than-life personality, a big heart, a giving nature, and the most generous spirit. It is impossible to summarize a person's life, especially this woman's life, in just a few minutes with just a few remarks. It's also impossible that this woman would not, in some way, have criticized these remarks I have just made. But that's okay, because it only means that I will continue to work at making you proud of me. Mom, we will love you and miss you forever. Go Lions.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Trusting in God, we pray together for Kate. And we'll come to the final farewell. There's sadness in parting, but we take comfort in the hope that one day you'll see her again, enjoy her friendship and her love. Although we as extended family disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of God's kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. Into your hands, Father of Mercies, we commend our sister Kate in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died, she will rise with the Lord on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings you bestowed upon us through Kate in her life. They are signs to us of your goodness. For Lord God, we now give Kate back to you. To you who gave her to us, and yet, as you did not lose her in the giving, so we do not lose her on her return. What is yours is ours, because we all belong to you. Love is undying. Life is unending. The boundary of this earthly life is but a horizon. A horizon is nothing more but the limit of our sight. So God, lift us up that our sights might see further. In faith, open our eyes that we might see more clearly. And as you prepare a place for Kate, prepare us also for your kingdom. We might be with you and those we love forever and ever. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord.
And let perpetual light shine upon her.
May she rest in peace.
Amen.
May your soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. In peace, we now take Kate's body to its place of rest. Dwell in the shelter of the Lord, bide in his shadow for life. Say to the Lord, my refuge,
my God, in whom I trust. He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The fowler will never capture you. Famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings, your refuge, his faithfulness, your shield. He will raise you up, eagle's wings.